In this video, I shall be discussing ophthalmic lenses and darkroom procedures in ophthalmology, and the discussion will be supplemented by lots of videos to give you a more realistic picture. Let's talk about ophthalmic lenses first. This is a trial box or trial case in which ophthalmic lenses used for performing subjective refraction and neutralization are kept. It has various sections, like that for minus spherical lenses, plus spherical lenses, minus cylindrical lenses, plus cylindrical lenses, prism lenses, accessory lenses, and a trial frame. So the basic and most important thing you need to know about the lenses is their identification. Accessory lenses have a very unique design, so identifying them is usually not a problem, while other lenses need some evaluation to identify them, especially if powers are not mentioned over them, as in exams or in spectacles. So we try to find out whether it is a plus lens or a minus lens, and then whether it's a sphere or a cylinder. Remember, when holding the lens, if a handle is present, hold the handle. If handle is absent, hold at the markings. So in exam, when you are asked to identify a lens, the first step is to close one eye. Hold the lens in front of the other eye and focus on a distant object. Then move the lens in vertical and horizontal directions and then rotate the lens. While doing this, note the following points. Is there any magnification or minification of image? What is the direction of movement of the image with respect to that of lens? Does the image move both during vertical and horizontal movements or only during one of them? And is there any distortion on rotation? The first 2 points will tell us if it's a plus lens or a minus lens, and the next 2 points will tell us if it's a sphere or a cylinder. So if there is magnification of image and the direction of movement of the image is opposite to that of lens, that means it's a plus lens. If the image moves during both vertical and horizontal movements and there is no distortion on rotation, that means it's a plus spherical lens. But if the image moves only during one of the movements and there is distortion on rotation, that means it's a plus cylindrical lens. This happens because cylindrical lens acts only on one axis and the other axis perpendicular to it has zero power, as compared to a spherical lens which has same power all over it. Have a look at this video. There is magnification of image and the direction of movement of the image is opposite to that of lens, which means it's a plus lens. The image is moving during both vertical and horizontal movements, and on rotation there is no distortion, which means it's a plus spherical lens. These plus spherical lenses are used for correction of refractive errors like hypermetropia, aphakia, and presbyopia, in which the rays of light are focused behind the retina. A plus sphere will help focus these rays over the retina. It is also used in various low vision aids. Different instruments also use plus sphere. A direct ophthalmoscope has both plus and minus spherical lenses, and a wheel is used to select the lens of choice and adjust the focus. Dialing the wheel clockwise increases the power, while anti-clockwise rotation decreases the power. For performing indirect ophthalmoscopy, a 20 diopter plus spherical lens is used. Microscope, synaptophore, and corneal loops also use plus spheres. 90 diopter or 78 diopter plus spherical lens is used for fundus biomicroscopy with a slit lamp. Other uses are in a Plaxido disc, identification of malingering, and different condensing lenses for laser therapy. Let's look at the second lens. There appears to be a slight magnification of image. Movement of the image is in opposite direction, which means it's a plus lens. Image is moving only during vertical movement but not during horizontal. That is, image is moving only during one of the movements. And there is also distortion on rotation. So this is a plus cylindrical lens. Cylindrical lenses in general are used for correction of astigmatism. A plus cylindrical lens is used in correction of regular hypermetropic astigmatism. Now if there is minification of image and direction of movement of image is same as that of lens, that means it's a minus lens. If image moves during both vertical and horizontal movements and there is no distortion on rotation, that means it's a minus spherical lens. But if the image moves only during one of the movements and there is distortion on rotation, that means it's a minus cylindrical lens. Look at this video. There appears to be slight minification of image. The direction of movement of the image is same as that of lens, which means it's a minus lens. the image is moving during both vertical and horizontal movements. And there is no distortion on rotation, which means this is minus spherical lens. A minus sphere is used in correction of myopia, where the light rays coming from infinity are focused in front of retina. A minus sphere will help focus these rays over the retina. Direct ophthalmoscopes, as we have already discussed, have both plus and minus spherical lenses. Ruby lens and fundus contact lenses are also minus spherical lenses. Looking at the next lens, there is minification of image. The direction of movement of image is same as that of lens, which means it's a minus lens. Now the image is moving only during vertical movement, but not the horizontal. And on rotation, there is distortion of image, which means it's a minus cylindrical lens. A minus cylinder is used in correction of regular myopic astigmatism. Apart from this, there are some add-on clues that you can use. Like the plus lenses are thicker in the center and thinner in the periphery, while minus lenses are thin at the center and thicker at the periphery. But these differences might not be very obvious in low powered lenses. Spherical lenses have got a handle and axis marking is absent, while in cylindrical lenses, handle is absent and markings are present. But these are just add-on clues, so do not answer only on basis of these, because there can be some trick questions. Like, look at this lens. There is no magnification, no minification, no movement of image. No distortion on rotation. This is a plain lens. And have a look at this lens. This is different from all the other lenses we have seen today. Here the image is displaced towards one side. There is no movement of image. And on rotation, there is no distortion. Rather, just the direction of displacement keeps on changing. This unique lens is a prism. Prism is a portion of refractive media bordered by two plane surfaces that are inclined at a finite angle. The thicker portion is known as base and the tapering portion apex. Looking at the optics of prism, it bends the incident ray of light towards the base. So if we trace the emergent ray backward, it appears to be coming from a point that is more towards the apex. So the image of the object is shifted towards the apex. Prisms commonly used in ophthalmology are trial prism, loose prism and prism bar, which consists of multiple prisms mounted over a bar in a graded manner. So as you can see, with progressively increasing power of lens, displacement of image keeps on increasing. Prisms can be used for objective measurement of deviation in squint using prism bar cover test and prism bar reflex test. This is a prism bar cover test in a patient with exotropia. Prisms of successively increasing power are kept in front of the deviated eye with apex towards the deviation till neutralization of movement on alternate cover test is obtained. It can also be used along with Madox rod for subjective measurement of deviation, and it has many other diagnostic and therapeutic uses. Many instruments also use prism. For example, a Goldman applanation tonometer, in which circular area of contact is converted into two semicircles using a prism. Other instruments like indirect ophthalmoscopes, slit lamps, etc. also use prism. They are also used in hemianopic spectacles and low vision aids. The next lens is a pinhole, which is a black disc with central hole of around 1 mm diameter attached to a handle. In a patient with refractive error, light rays are not focused over a point on retina. Rather, a blur circle is formed. What pinhole does is, it eliminates all the other rays except the central one, which passes through the nodal point of the eye, thus giving a clearer image by abolishing the effect of refractive error to some extent. It can neutralize refractive errors of up to 4 diopters. So when a patient complains of diminution of vision, he is asked to look at the Snellen's chart. Pinhole is placed in front of one eye, other eye is closed. He is asked whether his vision is better, unchanged or worse. If the image improves, that means patient has a refractive error. If the vision is unchanged, that means there is some ocular pathology. A decrease in vision indicates macular pathology. This is a patient's view of improvement of vision with pinhole. This is a stenopic slit. It is a black disc with slit-like opening that is 1 mm in width and 15 mm in length and a handle. It basically acts as an elongated pinhole. It is used in detection of axis for prescribing cylindrical lens. Fincham test to differentiate glaucomatous halos from cataractous halos. In case where corneal opacity is off-center and encroaches onto the pupillary area, an optical iridectomy may help in providing good ambulatory vision. Synopic slit helps to find out the best meridian for optical iridectomy. It is also used as a part of Madox wing. Red-green goggle is red on one side and green on other. If goggle is not available, red and green lenses can be mounted on a trial frame. Red is put over the right eye, green over the left eye. It is used to dissociate binocular single vision in various tests like Wurtz 4-dot test, diplopia charting, and Hess green test. The next lens is a Madox rod. It consists of multiple cylinders placed side by side with their axis parallel to each other. Now look what this arrangement of cylinders does to a point source of light. As you can notice, it converts the point source of light to a linear streak. This streak is perpendicular to the axis of cylinder. So here, when the axis of cylinder is horizontal, the streak is vertical. And when the axis of cylinder is made vertical, streak becomes horizontal. Madox rod test can be used for detection of latent squint, that is heterophoria, and also for subjective measurement of deviation. These tests are performed at 6 meters for distance and 33 cm for near deviation. Let's talk about detection of latent squint first. Suppose there is a patient of latent squint, say exophoria. When the patient fixates on a point source, a single image will be seen as phoria is overcome by the fusion reflex. But when Madox rod is held in front of one eye, image of the point source of light becomes dissimilar between two eyes, and thus fusion becomes dissociated and heterophoria becomes manifest. So in a patient with exophoria, light will now fall on the retina on a point that is more temporal to the fovea. So the image will be seen as being more nasal, and thus patient will have crossed diplopia. So in exophoria, there is crossed diplopia. In esophoria, light will fall on a point on retina that is more nasal to the fovea. So image will be shifted temporally. So in right eye exophoria, patient will see the line towards left. In right eye esophoria, towards right. In hypophoria, eye goes down and the red line is seen up. In hyperphoria, eye goes up and the red line is seen down. So remember, in all cases of Madox rod test, eye behind the Madox rod is deviating opposite to the direction of red line. Note that for testing vertical deviations, we will need a horizontal streak. So the orientation of Madox rod cylinders is kept vertical. Subjective measurement of deviation can be done using Madox rod. For this, Madox rod is placed in front of one eye and prism in front of the other eye. And the power of prism is kept on increasing until the images overlap. The power with which orthophoria is achieved will be the measure of subjective deviation. Both vertical and horizontal deviations can be measured, but the test cannot differentiate a phoria from tropia. Subjective torsion can also be measured. For this, double Madox rod test is used, in which the patient fixes on a point source of light. Each Madox rod is initially placed at 90 degrees in the trial frame. If necessary, a vertical prism is placed in front of one eye to disrupt fusion. A patient with normal subjective torsion will perceive two parallel horizontal lines. If an eye has abnormal torsion, lines will not be parallel, and the patient is asked to rotate appropriate Madox rod until lines become horizontal and parallel. The degree of subjective torsion matches the final position of Madox rod. For example, if a patient rotates lens from 90 to 95 degrees, the right eye has subjective extortion of 5 degrees. Coming to the last part of trial box, that is a trial frame. Trial frame has various compartments. First compartment, the one which is nearest to the eye, is for high powered lenses. Usually the plus lenses or near addition lenses used to correct the presbyopia. We want these lenses to be as close to the eye as possible, because as the distance of plus lenses from the eye increases, its effective power also increases. The second compartment is for spherical lens, third for cylindrical lens, and fourth for accessory lenses. Trial frame also has markings which are in form of cross. Horizontal line should align such that it cuts through the center of pupil. This is done by adjusting the nose rest. Vertical line should be aligned such that it cuts vertically through the center of pupil. This is done by adjusting the interpupillary distance, IPD. As you can see in this case, these lines are not bisecting the center of pupil and need adjustment. Proper alignment will ensure that the patient views the chart through the center of trial lens. Temple adjustment can be done for adding pantoscopic tilt to the frame. This is done to make it similar to the actual frame which the patient will wear. Pantoscopic tilt is the amount by which the frame is tilted with respect to the plane of face. So by rotating the knob, both nose rest and IPD can be adjusted. When testing one eye, the other eye is occluded using an occluder. Spherical lenses are placed in second compartment, and as they have a handle, they can't be rotated completely. And the rotation is not even needed as their power is uniform throughout. Cylindrical lenses are placed in third compartment, where markings are present, and they can be rotated 360 degrees to bring its axis to the desired marking. Absence of handle makes this rotation possible. And finally, accessory lenses can be placed in the anteriormost compartment. Coming to darkroom procedures in ophthalmology, I'll be discussing it as an approach to a patient presenting in OPD. Please note that these procedures are performed in dark room or semi-dark room. We have kept the lights on in the videos for demonstration purposes. So when a patient presents in OPD with decrease in vision, first, a distant direct ophthalmoscopy is done using direct ophthalmoscope at a distance of 20 to 25 centimeters to assess the state of fundus and detect any opacities in ocular media. If ocular media is clear, a red glow without any black shadow or opacity is seen, as in this case. If there is opacity or black shadow in the red glow, it indicates media opacity, and a distant direct ophthalmoscopy in 4 gazes is done to determine the location of the opacity by parallax principle. If the opacity is in the corneal plane, as in this case of keratoconus with oil droplet reflex, it will move in same direction of gaze. Opacity in iris plane will have no movement in gazes. If opacity is in the lens, as in this case of zonular cataract, it will move in a direction that is opposite to the direction of gaze. Sometimes there will be total absence of glow, even on different gazes. Like in the right eye of this patient, this is seen in vitreous hemorrhage and mature synovial cataracts. And look at this case of bilateral superior subluxation of lens. There is present of crescentic shadow. Distant direct ophthalmoscopy is said to be the best test for subluxated lenses. So this was when there was media opacity. If media is clear and yet there is decrease of vision, then a pinhole test should be performed. If there is improvement in the vision with pinhole, it indicates refractive error and a refraction should be performed. If there is no improvement with pinhole, it indicates posterior segment pathology and a direct or indirect ophthalmoscopy should be performed. Let's look at refraction. Objective refraction consists of retinoscopy and autorefraction. Subjective refraction consists of adjustment of refraction, refinement of cylinder, refinement of sphere, binocular balancing, and correction of near vision. Retinoscopy is done with the help of retinoscope, which may be a reflecting mirror retinoscope like plane mirror or Crisler Smith, or a self-illuminated retinoscope like spot retinoscope and streak retinoscope. The patient is made to sit at a distance of 1 meter. However, in practice, working distance of an arm length, that is 2/3 of a meter, is preferred, as it is more convenient and the examiner can easily hold the lenses in his left hand. Patient is asked to look at a far point to relax accommodation. However, when cycloplegic is used, patient can look directly into the light. The retinoscope is moved and movement of the retinal reflex is observed. Following observation and inferences are possible with plane mirror retinoscopy done at 1 meter. If shadow moves in same direction as streak, it is called as width movement. This indicates hypermetropia, immetropia, or myopia of less than 1 diopter. And plus lenses need to be added till point of neutralization is reached, at which there will be no movement of reflex. If shadow moves in a direction opposite to that of streak, it is called as against movement. This indicates myopia of more than 1 diopter, and minus lenses are added till the point of neutralization is reached. You can remember it using a mnemonic SPAM, that is for same movement or with movement add plus power, and for against movement add minus power. Sometimes there might be a cylindrical error and the streak will have to be rotated and cylindrical power added accordingly to reach the point of neutralization. A common source of confusion here is that why is the point of neutralization at myopia of 1 diopter and not at immetropia? To understand this, we need to know that there are three stages of retinoscopy. First stage is the illumination stage, in which the subject's retina is illuminated with the light of retinoscope. Second stage is reflex stage, in which the image of illuminated area of the retina is formed at the far point of the patient. Third stage is the projection stage, in which the reflex shadow is observed by the observer. Depending upon where the image is formed with respect to the observer, with, against and neutral reflex will be seen. In hypermetropia, the light rays emerging out of the eye are divergent, and in immetropia they are parallel. And in myopia of less than 1 diopter, they focus at a point behind the observer. Therefore, in all these conditions, a with reflex is seen. In myopia of more than 1 diopter, rays converge at a point between patient and the observer, and an against movement is seen. At myopia of 1 diopter, the rays converge at a point 1 meter in front of the patient, exactly where the observer is present. When retinoscope is moved, observer does not appreciate any movement, that is, neutralization is achieved. So if the observer is at 1 meter, for neutralization to occur, the eye should converge the rays arising from the illuminated retina at 1 meter, that is, its focal point should be at 1 meter. If you look at the formula for power of lens, it is equal to 1 upon focal length. So for focal length to be 1 meter, the power of eye has to be 1 diopter. Therefore, for an observer sitting at 1 meter, neutralization will be at myopia of 1 diopter. If examiner sits at 2/3 of a meter, for neutralization to occur at 2/3 of a meter, focal length has to be 2/3 of a meter. And thus, power of the eye at which neutralization will take place is myopia of 1.5 diopter. So the point of neutralization will depend on the working distance. And appropriate deduction from the retinoscopic findings need to be done according to the working distance. That is 1 diopter for 1 meter and 1.5 diopter for 2/3 of a meter. As we have already discussed, in a patient with good glow on distant direct ophthalmoscopy but no improvement with pinhole, ophthalmoscopy needs to be performed. In direct ophthalmoscopy, the examiner stands on the side of the eye to be examined. Patient is asked to look straight ahead. When examining the right eye of patient, examiner holds the ophthalmoscope in his right hand and examines with his right eye. Examiner moves as close to the patient's eye as possible, theoretically at the anterior focal plane of the patient's eye, which is around 1.5 cm from the cornea. And for left eye of the patient, scope in his left hand and examine using left eye. This is the view of the fundus that examiner gets during direct ophthalmoscopy, which is around 5 degrees. Once retina is focused, blood vessels can be traced back to the disc. Details of disc, macula and blood vessels are noted. Indirect ophthalmoscopy can be performed to get a larger view of around 45 degrees. It gives a 3D stereoscopic view and is also useful in hazy media. Comparing the images obtained on direct and indirect ophthalmoscope, the image is erect, virtual and 14 to 15 times magnified in direct ophthalmoscope, and that on indirect ophthalmoscope is real, inverted and around 3 times magnified. Thanks for watching the video. If you found the video useful, please let me know in the comment section. And don't forget to like, share and subscribe.